Hi, I'm Michael Dougherty, the co-writer and director of Krampus.
I'm Zach Shields, co-writer and executive producer.
And I'm Todd Casey, co-writer and co-producer.
And thanks for joining us on this DVD home video audio commentary. And winter in outer space, which I don't know how that works, but it's happening. It's Krampus magic. I do remember, funny enough, we wanted to use the 1982 Universal logo. Because this was very much done in the style and spirit of 80s horror movies, but we were denied. Our opening title sequence is a fun little scene. It's done in the spirit of Black Friday shopping sprees. It doesn't technically happen on Black Friday, but it was inspired by Black Friday.
Well, I mean, every year you see that there's a bunch of news stories of the crazy stuff that happens. And
yeah,
you know, inspiration, Mike, from the world around us.
Well, the fun thing about the sequence, too, is that it was the only day that we shot on location, and this was done at a store in New Zealand called Mitre 10, which is sort of their version of a big box store. And we had to create our own store to avoid getting sued. But I don't think we could have shot this in the United States. I don't think a single store would have let us get away with this.
Yeah, it's kind of like their Home Depot, too, and everything was
orange. It was a little bit more of a hardware store, but we tried to make it a little bit more like an American box store. But the other big challenge of the scene was finding minorities. Because, I mean, New Zealand is not the most diverse country. It's a great place, but it's just not that diverse. So we had to find as many multicultural American faces as we could. I think we got every single one in the country. And getting the music for the scene, actually getting the music for everything in the film was pretty challenging too. Because I think they were afraid that we were too much of a horror movie. And so we had to explain to the rights holders of the songs that this is very tongue-in-cheek, it's very fun, and it has a sense of humor. And it's much more of a dark fairy tale fantasy film.
Is the holly that will be on your own front door. Sure, it's Christmas once more.
I come tonight to warn you that you will be visited by...
A Christmas carol.
I think it was important that we started on this, too, sort of setting up what happens later in the story. You know, it's famously a story of someone who goes on a, you know, pretend journey or a, you know, maybe a real journey with ghosts to learn a lesson about himself.
There's definitely some not-so-subtle foreshadowing by starting with A Christmas Carol, because I'm assuming that anyone who's actually listening to our commentary has seen the film, but...
I know, I started to like be like, am I going to spoil the end of the person who watches it the first time?
I think we're allowed to talk spoilers, but this is definitely very much a modern-day Christmas carol. And so that was sort of our attempt at informing the audience that shit's going to get weird.
Is Ben Kuklinski also the name of the Iceman killer, the mafia hitman?
I don't think so, is
no,
it?
I thought he had Kuklinski or something as the last name.
I love... like Polish-sounding names because they sound so hilarious. They got so many syllables.
Yeah, and you're gonna ski. Oh, it sounds good.
Oh, I know. I just...
Since this is the first scene where we get to meet at least half of our main cast, I'd love to talk about the process of finding these people because it was a challenge and a really rewarding challenge, but we lucked out in terms of our cast. I mean, these are amazing actors and... A lot of them, most of them, I think, we created our cast list and we got everybody.
Yeah.
Which was a Christmas miracle. I keep saying that the movie itself is sort of a string of Christmas miracles, and this cast is definitely one of them.
Yeah, when we were writing it, I mean, this is pretty much the cast list that we had written out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, MJ was definitely a discovery, mm-hmm. and Stefania was a discovery. All the kids were, but the adults, with the exception of Krista Stodler, they were all people that we thought about. And Krista, who is an actual native Austrian, that was, finding her was a bit of a fiasco because we had three other actresses in the role who all had to bow out for very mysterious reasons. Very ominous, strange reasons.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Krista came on, I mean, days.
About a week and a half, 2 weeks before we started shooting, we finally found Krista. And I don't think it was an accident that she came from Austria.
Yeah, she was sent just in time.
Well, Krista actually grew up with the Krampus legend. She encountered Krampus many times as a little girl coming to her village and school. So she was more than familiar with it, and she was really proud to be a part of it. But everybody else signed on really quickly. Mm. Our first actor was Allison Tolman, who we haven't met yet.
Oh, yeah.
It was Allison and then MJ. And
then Adam, right?
Thanks,
Obi. I think Adam came on board after MJ. I'm pretty sure it was Allison, then MJ.
But then Adam.
And then Adam, yeah. Oh,
believe in Santa.
And then MJ was... came under the strong recommendation from Jon Favreau, who worked with him on Chef, and they played father and son. But, MJ's a real kid to watch.
Real ladies, man.
Yes.
My girlfriend.
MJ Anthony.
My girlfriend came to set and he started hitting on her.
Every single female cast or crew member, I think, was flirted with by MJ Anthony. He's a little player.
Yeah.
Fun little note on this shot, it's mostly digital. So our house doesn't exist.
Like candy.
95% of the movie was shot on a soundstage, including that establishing shot of the house. And what we did was we built the bottom level and everything else was a digital set extension, including the neighborhood.
Very enticing.
And that is through the magic work of What a Digital.
And she is CGI.
But yes, the secret is this movie actually cost $150 million. And no, Stefania Owen is completely CG. No, that's not true. Stefania is a very talented young actress. And funny bit about Stefania is that she is a Kiwi. She's from New Zealand. But she was at the top of the list before we decided to go to New Zealand. So she was auditioning for the film when we were still thinking about shooting in the States or potentially shooting in Canada. And so she was in our top choices. And when we moved to New Zealand to shoot, it turned out she lived 15 minutes away. And then when she came in and she got the role, she happened to bring her little sister, Lolo Owen, who's about to walk in the door. And she was cast as Stefania's cousin. And that's Maverick Flack, who is also from New Zealand. So all of our kids, with the exception of MJ, were Kiwis.
Thanks, Tommy.
Sorry
about that. Butt with a night off, did you?
And then the very talented David Koechner. I've been a fan of his forever. Been dying to work with him. But a fun piece of trivia with Koechner was that, again, before we ever cast him, our storyboard artist, Simeon Wilkins, was drawing him in the storyboards. So
yeah, it was like pretty unbelievable, like when we realized afterwards, looking back at the drawings, like he was doing it on purpose, but I did not know that he was.
Yeah. Simeon was drawing the storyboards. This is still when we were doing rewrites on the movie. And I guess Simeon happened to be watching Anchorman in the background while he was sketching, and so he just started drawing Koechner as the model in the storyboards. And then, lo and behold, Koechner got the role. So I still want Simeon to just draw us with, like, giant mansions and spaceships and aliens and see if he can manifest those as well.
Surprise!
Ah, Conchata. So I don't know if a lot of people know it, but Conchata has a very long and distinguished career. Most recently, she had just finished 12 years on Two and a Half Men when she came on board our movie. But I've been a huge fan of hers going all the way back to the late 70s, early 80s. I mean, she was in Network, which is one of my all-time favorite films. But she's been in Edward Scissorhands and...
Oh, yeah, she is in Edward Scissorhands.
Yeah,
she's great in that.
She's great in everything.
Yeah.
But I've been wanting to work with her forever. And so I was very happy that we got her. I was really amazed that...
Come on, girls.
We suckered our whole cast to flying out to New Zealand.
Yeah, it's like really, you know, if you have a family relocating, but everybody seemed to bring their families.
Yeah, everybody brought their family out at one point or another.
Yeah, lunch there was like the chaos of their Christmas dinner every day.
So many kids.
MJ shooting.
So many kids.
With Nerf
yeah,
guns
I feel
constantly.
Like people just started bringing random kids just to like hang out yeah. with our kids. The funny thing was that Tony had just moved from Sydney to Los Angeles when we offered her the role, and so she had to fly back pretty much around the world. Oh, and baby Chrissy, who was played by Sage Hunfeld, and we had baby auditions. You guys weren't around for that, but I had, for 3 weeks, did baby auditions. And at one point, there was just a room full of babies on the floor. And it was like, pick one. Like, okay.
How'd you choose?
It was like a fight club kind of thing. So the babies had to fight. And then Sage won out because she has a really mean uppercut. No, Sage won out because she's just a delight. And she wasn't afraid to get picked up or be handled by strangers. And she was just adorable. But then when she got on set, it wasn't as easy because it's just different circumstances.
Lights.
Well, it was something about the costume. There was something about the hat or the pajamas that really bothered her.
And the screaming people.
Yeah. Just so much. Yeah, and the screaming noises. People and the elves and the monsters. That might have had something to do with it. I don't know.
No. It was actually quite a bit of...
So now we've got our whole family gathered together at Christmas dinner, and this is, I think, modeled after... sort of everyone's collective experiences around the holidays. A shepherd has got. I've definitely had a few family dinners like this.
Yeah, things can get awkward fast.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, God, I love Maverick munching on the chicken.
He's fantastic.
Careful, kids. Remember that your Aunt Sarah likes everything.
It's a pure coincidence, Mom, that you... also make foods that no one can pronounce. Totally not you. Oh, right.
Well, the macaroni and cheese and hot dogs line, too. I mean, that was one of my favorite meals growing up. It was macaroni. I mean, it's still sort of like a comfort food of mine. Like, every now and then, Kraft macaroni and cheese with diced up hot dogs. Like, I grew up in Ohio, and that was gourmet eating. It was a casserole made with macaroni and cheese
and hot dogs. I can't eat it anymore.
Oh.
I had a babysitter, and she made it for me one day, and then I drank a bunch of her Slim Fast because I thought they were milkshakes. And I went swimming in her above-ground pool.
Please tell me this ends in diarrhea.
No. Or vomit.
Yeah. Vomit. I threw up.
Of course. Yeah.
Chlorine.
Yeah.
And hot dogs. No, Stevie,
what happened to Santa? Something I think is really interesting is the structure of our story, because we are really committed to making sure that while this movie has horror elements and comedic elements... it really sort of dips around in a bunch of different genres, and one of the most important ones for us was the Christmas movie genre, which I think is sort of its own subgenre because Christmas movies can entail aspects of drama or dramedy or fantasy. But it was really important for us that the first 15 minutes, the first act of the film, are a straight Christmas movie, and that the only time we even hint at the horror to come is the opening company credits, where we hear sort of the spooky voices and the creepy wind. And then there's that little tiny moment when MJ asks Krista, do you still believe in Santa Claus? And she clearly gets lost in some dark thought. But that it was really important to us that the first act be modeled and be faithful to Christmas movies.
versus a traditional horror film, which always seems to start off with some scary hook of some girl running through the woods, getting killed off, and then you smash cut to a title sequence. Yeah. We didn't want to embrace the horror movie tropes yet. We really wanted to be faithful to this is a Christmas movie.
Yeah, I think it's super cool that Thomas and Alex and John and everyone got that's yeah. what we wanted to do, because I think it very easily could have been, you know, a different experience of having to have that opening kill to hook people, and they were super cool about let's go for it.
I mean, to me, like, this is the scene where the movie could have gone in two different directions, and if the letter was never read aloud, and if MJ never tore up the letter, then it could have continued on as a very traditional Christmas film, and it's really just about these characters and this family trying to figure out their personal issues along the way, like a typical Christmas movie might. But it's because of this letter and his coming loss of faith that turns it into the dark fairy tale fantasy horror film. But from the casting to the writing, we wanted to make sure that the first act was just a Christmas movie. And I think it's worked pretty well. That seems to be what people... It was a risk. It was a big risk for us. But we wanted to spend more time actually establishing our characters and sort of the tongue-in-cheek tone before we get into cloven-hoofed horned demons.
Yeah, I think it was good to show everyone's personality and give them an opportunity to all grow, because they all grow and learn and change over the course of the story, and getting to learn their flaws in the beginning was important to us too.
Yeah. I just wanted Christmas to be like you. Maybe we should, I mean, on that note, maybe we can talk about how the movie came to be, because it was such a long process for us.
Yeah, it started one night with you and I, Mike, talking, looking at like pictures of people having Krampus festivals in Eastern Europe and remote parts of Europe, and it's really incredible. If you just look online for videos of people celebrating, it's just tons of people in giant fur wood mask costumes carrying torches and whips through a snowy little...
Well, it's just such a fun legend. And I bought my first Krampus book in 2004, according to my Amazon order record. There's a great book out there that really has a bunch of postcards that were sent out as part of Krampus traditions for, how many years? I mean, it goes back so far. The actual folklore goes supposedly predates Christianity, and it was huge in Europe. And it was sort of in the early 2000s when people started emailing Krampus postcards to each other. At least that's where I first saw them, and they got collected in a book. But I've always wanted to do a scary Christmas movie, because most scary Christmas movies just involve a guy dressed up in a Santa Claus suit with an axe running around killing people. But there was never a Christmas movie about that sort of supernatural, fantastical magic that we're all supposed to believe in around that time of year.
Yeah, and actually thinking about those postcards, there is a playful, funny element to them also.
Yeah.
Kind of like, you know, he's like driving a little old car around
or
whatever.
Or he's flirting with women.
Yeah, and then they're like, so it already had built into it kind of a sense of humor.
But I remember we talked about that for a long time. We were trying to figure out what is the tone of this film. And there are versions, I mean, early outlines and treatments that nobody will ever see. And, I mean, the evolution that I remember was that you and I, Todd and I, were trying to crack it, and it just felt too much like a horror movie. You know, it just had people in this small town getting picked off one by one by Krampus over the course of a week or days or something.
Yeah.
And you know, the townspeople can't figure it out, and it just felt too much like a horror film.
I remember actually you saying, I can picture the exact trailer for this movie in my head, and I know it's just going to be so obvious. It's all going to be so obvious, and we have to do something different. And so this is really like the second version of it. And I think, you know, you were right that it was like the first version you think of. The bad version was just the...
Yeah. Yeah, the first version sucked. And but, I mean, and just so people understand, because it's such a long evolution, and you have to be willing to kill your darlings, and And there was a point when we even thought we could do this as a micro-budget movie.
Oh, yeah.
I was sort of like, we could just shoot it in my house. We'll just get some friends together and shoot it in my house. It'll be easy.
But when I came into the equation when around that time, and I remember I had never heard of Krampus before, and Mike's wondering, like, do you want to do a Krampus movie with Todd and I? I was like, oh, what the f*** is a Krampus?
But the thing is, you weren't into it at first.
No, I wasn't into it, because I love Christmas, and I'm not the biggest horror buff. I love spooky. I love me some Disney spooky. Yeah, when it was the first version of it, I was like, it doesn't really sound like something I would want to see, you know? I want to do a Christmas movie that keeps the Christmas intact, and I think that was a moment that we started shifting.
That was when some magic happened.
Yeah.
I mean, not that we were surprised. We were all friends by that point.
Yeah.
And we were trying to find stuff to work on. But when you said that you loved Christmas, I think you specifically said, you're like, I don't want to shit on Christmas. And I was like, wait, that's it. It's not just a horror movie. It has to be a Christmas movie. And then came the idea of, well, what if it's a family Christmas movie that essentially gets invaded by a horror movie? And then that led to what would cause that? Well, it would be about a kid losing his faith in Christmas that would open up that door. Mm. And then it really, no pun intended, snowballed from there.
I think we started with the family. I think when we got into it, we started with creating the family and the family dynamic and just felt like for weeks we just sat around and talked about who the characters were.
Yeah, that was like one of the
what was going on with them.
Yeah, and just there was a lot of permutations of how many kids there were going to be, mm-hmm. and you know, I think at one point Howard had 4 daughters and a son or something, and then we're like, there's like 20 people in this movie.
There were so many kids.
We end up killing off some kids.
Yeah. The fact that he's given them all boys' names was more obvious. When there was 4 of them.
Yes.
Right. That he was giving them sort of like gender-neutral names in his quest to have a son.
And I think our the tone also sort of wrote itself, too, because we decided, especially around then, that it can't be a serious horror movie. Not that our original version was, but there was something more playful happened when we decided to make it a family that was under threat. Because we realized we could really milk all the different family dynamics and tensions between in-laws and cousins. And also, frankly, I think, addressing class issues. Not that we want to get too deep, but it was sort of fun to take the obvious conservative part of the family, blue-collar part of the family, and make them the guests of the more likely left-wing liberal family and watch that tension come to a head. And I think it was sort of our way of saying, well, both you guys are idiots, and you need to get along if you're going to survive this. Maybe it's sort of our commentary on the election cycle.
Yeah, I guess, the Angles are, pretty judgmental of their in-laws and, who just are what they are, and they like hunting.
The thing is, even for me, though, it's like I was raised, we all were, had very middle-class suburban upbringings. Mm-hmm. And I've got family that definitely are more blue-collar. And in some ways, it was my way of trying to figure out how I deal with this part of the family. Fun thing about these shots, these moments, this whole scene, actually, is it's all shot indoors on a soundstage. And most of it is practical in camera. But we did sweeten some elements with more wedded digital CG trickery. That's definitely something I wanted to mention, is that in the tradition of the movies that we are inspired by, we tried to use as many old-school in-camera methods as possible, such as puppets and animatronics and actual stages, but wedded digital did play a very big hand there. So for that shot, for example, Krampus is practical, but the roof that he's standing on and that background is all digital.
They are just incredible.
Yeah.
And because they can do everything.
Yeah. The fun thing is that the technology has advanced so much that stuff like this, that's a digital Krampus running across the roof, running through a digital neighborhood, and Stefania, and her set is all 100% real, but the snow was added digitally. But a lot of these methods and techniques and tools, which were usually the exclusive domain of big tentpole movies, you know, your Jurassic Parks and your Star Wars, now they're pretty readily available to small movies like us because our budget was not big, but we really wanted to make it feel big using a lot of these tools.
And it's like, visiting the set and looking on your monitor, so like that's the shot. Like you're not looking at a person dangling in a green screen. You can see like pretty much how the movie's gonna look. And it was really incredible for me to go and be like, oh, it's all happening right here. It's like a play, the whole set, all the monsters and everything is in camera. And
then we use practical Krampus for when we can. So for this sequence, I mean, all the hoofs and chains, everything, that's all real. But we did add breath.
Added breath, but the steam off of his hoofs is
real.
Is real.
Yeah. So yeah, because it was a steamer.
That's all it was.
It was just like an off the shelf steamer. But the fun thing about the breath in the film is that while it was added digitally, a lot of it, I think most of it, was shot. So they shot actual breath in
freezers, right?
In freezers. Like, they put people in freezers.
And that's where we got the frozen DHL guy from.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we unfroze him. He's fine now. But they would go ahead and say the lines or act out the scenes and shoot the breath and then composite it in. So it has a quality to it that feels very real.
Thank you to those anonymous individuals who breathed.
Yeah.
One cool thing about the snow is that it's the majority of it, some of it's foam, but the majority of it is actually diaper material. I'm serious. They take the big blocks of the foam that they use from a diaper factory, and they put it in this thing that chops it up into small
flakes. That was the snow on the... I think the snow that falls...
Snow that falls is different. That's right. The foam.
Yeah, we learned all about fake snow.
All the snow on the ground is diapers.
That's so weird. Yeah, no wonder it's so absorbent.
Yeah.
100 words for fakes of snow in New Zealand. And what a...
Yeah, right.
It's also really cold, too, and there was the trenches where everybody would have to... where the actors would walk through, because the set was built up 3 feet, and then there'd be a trench of 3 feet of snow when the actors had to trudge through the snow.
Yeah.
And the crew had a rule where if anybody fell into the snow, they'd have to buy the rest of the crew beer.
There was a lot of beer.
Yeah, and one day there was seven beer buys.
I fell through.
I fell through.
Yeah, everybody fell through. So I think this is the point in the film when... I mean, obviously, this is when the horror movie starts.
How's everybody else doing?
And we also, I was really conscious about the color palette and going from the very bright, warm, cheery, saturated colors from the first act into more of the grays and blues after the power goes out.
God, I miss us. In the Campbell storytelling tradition of crossing a magical threshold, it sort of crosses
you
over.
This is Todd.
If you hear someone screaming, it's Mike and I kicking the shit out of Todd.
I'm sorry, I won't say anything insightful anymore.
Till we get to the atonement with the father, guys. And then
20 minutes in the movie, and you're talking about Joseph Campbell already. Sound like a film
school
nerd.
Todd, your lunch is here, but you're not allowed to eat it. He's going to steal it from you.
Anyway, but yeah, this is definitely the shift into the horror movie, and we wanted to take our time. I definitely miss films which take their time to give you characters that you can establish even while the larger plot is simmering.
Yeah, and in some way you can, the goal of starting it as a family Christmas movie is you get time to invest in the people and get to know them and have some stake in what happens to them. So when bad things start to happen,
you give
them,
a shit.
Care, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And the other thing is, I think we purposely made the first act and the characters as we meet them in that first act. I mean, they're not that they're completely cliche, but they're definitely embracing certain tropes. You have the uptight suburban mom, here comes a blue-collar family, and the intent was to always let the characters deepen and become more complex as we go along so that you can see, like, oh, they're not a bunch of cliches. Because I think the characters within the film are viewing the other characters as cliches.
Yeah.
You know, so you have your uptight J. Crew family looking down on the more Old Navy part of the family as they show up, but it's only as they get further and deeper into the fantasy fairy tale aspect where they start to realize, oh, there's more to them.
I don't necessarily like when there's characters that you're supposed to want to see die, yeah. You know, and like we wanted everyone to be likable, mm-hmm. You know, and you were like scared for all their lives, even the people who are jerks.
Yeah, I don't get the whole idea that horror movies are about seeing people that you dislike dying.
Yeah, it feels sort of sadistic to me.
Yeah. Yeah, you need to genuinely like your characters in order for it to be engaging. Again, soundstage, all practical. There's no digital trickery in this stuff. But it was just as miserable shooting in this stuff as it was shooting in real snow, man. I think, at times. And especially because the hard part with shooting the film, too, was that since the majority of it takes place at night, we would just go from one dark soundstage to another, even if it was bright and sunny and beautiful outside. Yeah. And that really starts to get to you.
Yeah,
you get just eternal night for 2 months.
Seasonal affect disorder from shooting a winter movie.
Yeah, when I first heard New Zealand, I was like, yeah, this is gonna be awesome. And then when you wake up and it's dark and you go into a dark soundstage.
Right. Yeah.
And then you leave and it's dark.
Yeah.
And that's what you do for 2 months.
Yeah. And you're breathing all this fake atmosphere.
Yeah.
And
it could have been anywhere in the world. It didn't matter, you know, particularly that it was in New Zealand.
But I mean the beauty of shooting in New Zealand, a big reason we went, there were a lot of big reasons, but the opportunity to work with both Weta Workshop and Weta Digital, who are two separate companies, they're sister companies, but very different set of artists with skill. So Weta Workshop would handle all the creatures and costumes, the specialty costumes like the elves and Krampus himself, and then Weta Digital handled all VFX with some additional VFX vendors to handle snow and breath and stuff like that. But all the digital creatures that we've seen so far and the ones to come were done by Weta Digital. But also, the crew in New Zealand, they're all veterans of Peter Jackson's movies. So they've worked on 6 Lord of the Rings films now and King Kong and a whole bunch of other stuff. And it's just such an amazing crew. Really, really amazing.
Yeah, it has a real family feel to it because it's the same group of people that they might swap out job to job, but they all know each other.
Yeah.
And each job position only goes like three to five people deep. It's like there's only like 3 script supervisors in all of New Zealand.
In the whole country, right? Yeah. But everyone's just so warm and friendly that you feel like an asshole no matter what. It's sort of like because you're American, and then you're in the land of people who are just super friendly and kind. Yeah. Doesn't like you almost feel like they're being so nice just on purpose to make you feel like a dick. It's hard to describe.
Yeah.
They're amazing. This whole house interior too, it's all soundstage. It's a miracle that we were able to build as much as we did, because you know we definitely talked about the potential of shooting this on location in a house, but with all the chaos that we needed to create, it wouldn't have been practical or economical.
No. Also, another interesting fact is you can only have the baby cry on a movie set. What is it, one time in a day?
Well, I feel like that rule got made up for us. I feel like that rule got made up because we made the baby cry too much or something. I don't think that's
a real rule.
I don't think that's a real rule.
They really made you feel like it was a real rule.
Basically, I mean, you know, listen, it's a horror movie and it's got kids in it. And we were very careful to make sure that our kids weren't exposed to anything that was too traumatic, but babies find bright lights traumatic. And
well, that's the thing is that if you bring a baby in a loud room with a bunch of people running around, and
it's gonna cry
every once in a while,
yeah,
and so you can't regulate that. And But they did regulate that.
Yeah, and so
the baby took a lot of walks.
There were times when the baby cried when we needed it to, and when we didn't need it to. And then we had the sort of not the stunt baby, but there was a stand-in baby for shots where, because you also have very limited hours. That was a huge challenge of working on this film, was between the kids and the dogs and the baby. We had to be very, very efficient because we had a very tight 40-day shoot, and you get only so many hours per day with the kids. We had a lot of doubles, for including with MJ and the girls, and so we would shoot all of their coverage first, and then every now and then, if we did an over-the-shoulder shot, we would throw in a double. So I haven't learned that from that rule, because everyone says don't ever work with kids or animals.
Yeah.
And I keep doing it. I mean, on Trick or Treat, it was nothing but kids and animals.
Yeah.
There's just such fun characters to include. I get bored of movies that are all about either just grown-ups or, especially in horror movies, they're just about dumb teenagers.
Yeah, and
the teenagers. Yeah.
Kids are awesome because they're speak truth, and a lot, everything is high drama to them, and
they're fun to have on set too.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely, they lighten the mood, and
especially for this. I mean, if you can't do this story about somebody losing their imagination or that crossing the crossing that threshold of when you are a child and you have a lot of imagination, then you come into adulthood or adolescence, and people start telling you to stop believing in magic.
Yeah, that's what this movie's really about.
You can't do that as a cynical teenager.
No.
Or a grumpy old man.
Yeah. I mean, we talked about this at length as we were getting into it, but the Krampus legend is really about this entity that steals children. So you had to include kids in the story. They had to be the target. And to me, there's nothing more frightening than a parent trying to protect their kids from something they can't protect them from. But also tonally, I think, you know, we had a lot of discussions about the tone, and that continued through the process of making it deep into post-production through marketing. And it was so important to us that it have just the right blend of scary and funny, cute and creepy, because, again, the Krampus myth already has that. You brought up the postcards and how they show Krampus riding around in, you know, antique cars.
Yeah, he's like a little sidecar of a motorcycle.
Like, there's something that's just so gleefully mischievous. Like, he always has a great smile on his face.
Yeah, and he likes his work.
Yeah, so it's just, it didn't make sense to make this a straightforward, gory, intense horror movie. This isn't The Shining. It's definitely not torture porn. To make a Krampus movie without a sense of humor would be stupid and not in keeping with the spirit of the movie.
Yeah.
Because it's really, it's meant for kids. It's a fable that parents use to keep their kids in line. So it was important to us that the film embraced that. And that also included the PG-13 rating, which I think is kind of the elephant in the room if we want to talk about that.
Yeah, not that I dislike horror, but I'm not, like, as into it as you are, Mike, in terms of, like, living and breathing it. And I know that it's, like, sacrilegious to have a PG-13 horror movie, but I was happy about it.
Well, I don't think
it.
That.
You don't think that.
No.
But, in the horror culture, you know, there was some questioning of, like, well, why is it PG-13? But it is a hybrid movie, and I think it demands that rating more than an R. And
well, I was on the fence for a long time, too. I mean, even into post-production.
Yeah, yeah.
We were
always
debating
talking about it.
But I know Zach was very big on making sure that it was, because that one shot, we just passed it. That was our one, one shot with blood was David Koechner's leg wound.
Yeah. Yeah, I was really intense about it being PG-13. Like, that was my vote. But, you know, we didn't know. And it's also, you have no control over it. It's one of my adult moments where I felt like a teenager again.
Yeah.
Where parents were going to decide my fate. They were going to tell me what was best for me. Like, we were just, this is like a thing I made. And then they're going to say, R, PG, they rate it. You're back in school in some setting.
You get a grade, essentially.
And you can't determine that. I mean, there's some guesswork involved, but.
Well, here's a funny thing. Like, this moment here, Howie Jr. drinking out of that cup, that was flagged as a moment of concern because we were showing underage kids drinking. And that and kids in these kinds of movies is a huge red flag as far as ratings go, because anytime you show kids in danger, the MPAA gets really sensitive, and especially kids around guns, which we also have.
Yeah.
And so, but that doesn't mean anything. She may have found some. Just a moment of a kid taking a teeny sip of spiked hot chocolate, there was concern that might earn us an R rating because of that. It's okay to show a kid getting swallowed by a clown monster.
Yeah.
But,
yeah, that was no problem.
Yeah. So, but I think, you know, stepping back, there was a spirit that we were trying to embrace, which is the spirit of 80s Amblin movies. So Gremlins and Poltergeist being two of the biggest ones, both of which were PG. And the fun of those movies, I think, for us as kids growing up, was that technically you were allowed to see it, and once you saw it, typically with your parents, it was, I can't believe we were allowed to watch that. I can't believe that was a PG. Like, I remember that's how I felt watching Gremlins and Poltergeist as a kid. And I think that's what we wanted to go for here, too, is this notion that, yeah, it's PG-13, but maybe it should be PG-15 if that existed. Sure. Which
version of it? Yeah, Gremlins was definitely what I saw as a kid, and it was, like, just scary enough for me to
but
get something out of
this
little kid.
There's something that Zach said that really struck a chord with me when we were having the discussions about the rating, and that was that you would have been upset if kids wouldn't have been able to see this.
Yeah.
Which I think that really sold me on it.
Cool, yeah, that, because when we were making it, I felt like the nice part of having this job as a grown-up is that you get to keep your childhood, you know, your imagination alive and the excitement of that. And I feel like we were making this movie as adults for our life now, but also for ourselves when we were that age.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, it's the movie we would have all loved to go see.
Yeah.
You know, fifth or sixth grade.
Well, I also don't mind the idea that that this is PG-13, because Trick or Treat was a hard R. Not a hard R, it was, I think it's actually a soft R. This is PG-13, and then ideally, knock on wood, Trick or Treat 2 goes back to being hard R. Because it should be.
I thought you were going to say, and Trick or Treat goes to PG, and we're just going to
do a G horror movie. No, I just, that the idea, like the idea that Trick or Treat's sort of the darker, meaner cousin.
Right, but well, it's on Halloween, too.
And it makes sense.
Which is like mischief and fun, but it is built for that.
But I like the idea that Krampus is meant to be a family horror film, which is a rarity these days, and that hopefully our audience who's listening to this commentary, asking themselves why they're listening to this commentary.
All three of
or,
you.
No, but the idea that you would share it with your family. I mean, when this, you know, I think we already witnessed that a lot in the theatrical, that families were going together, which is why we did as good as we did. High five.
Sure, my whole family, I have a huge family, and I mean, they're my family, so they're going to see, but I have like 40 cousins and, you know, 10 aunts and uncles just on my mom's side.
Yeah.
And in my mom's side of the family, we're the blue collar, like black sheep side of the family.
Right.
I remember like us living
in. You're the Burkhausers.
Yes, exactly. We're the ones showing up to my fancy cousin's house feeling like, oh, do we belong here? Like, should I touch that?
It's expensive.
I can't fix it if
That's
I break
funny.
It.
That's funny.
And so, you know, everybody does have some memory of being on one side of that line or the other.
Yeah.
That line always exists. And, you know, getting to experience that, an outlet, while you're going through it at the same time, it being a Christmas movie, and people can go see this and watch that happen. And the idea would be that what happens if something, if you get put in a terrible situation, like how are you going to bond together or are you going to fall apart?
Yeah. And I think we've been subjected to too many movies that show everybody falling apart, whether it's zombie movies or post-apocalyptic. It's just we've seen movie after movie or TV show after TV show that depicts people falling apart and going at each other's throats when shit goes down. But we wanted to show, created a film where people actually come together and try to get through it and frankly get to know each other as people and not just the archetypes that we talked about. The other thing, that, you know, one more thing on the rating, and then I guess we should probably talk about something else. But it's, I get the idea that most PG-13 horror movies do suck. I get it. Like, because I remember when our rating got announced, people were like, what do you mean? Look, PG-13 movies suck, horror movies suck. And I get that skepticism. But I think when you really do step back and look at all the horror movies that come out, there are some really, really good PG and PG-13 ones. Gremlins, Poltergeist, Jaws, The Others, The Sixth Sense. I mean, the list goes on and on. So it doesn't mean that just because something is R and filled with gore doesn't mean it's good. If you rely on it, just doesn't, yeah. You know. And just because you have a bunch of gore and horror in your movie doesn't make it good. It makes it bloody and repulsive. But repulsion is a different emotional response than genuine fear, dread, or suspense, which is what horror is really about. Mm. I mean, it'd be easy just to pour, you know, buckets of fake blood down that chimney in that shot, for example, and it doesn't make it scary. It just makes it gross. So...
Agreed.
Yeah.
So I know you guys are keeping up on the Campbell part of the story. Max has got his moment where his family is getting along finally, despite losing his sister.
Hey, Todd, do you, man. Yeah. Stick to your guns.
He's come to a place of rest.
But I do think this is another turning point in the film, because up until now, the threat has been somewhat vague. We've seen this various sort of mysterious silhouetted figure on the rooftops.
And it stayed outside the house. I mean, this is its breaching yeah. the gate yeah. for the first time.
You know, and we know that there's something under the snow, but this is the first time when I think we start to reveal the more comedic and mischievous nature of Krampus.
Yeah, it's kind of the point in which the comedy comes from the characters in the first half of the story, and then it comes from the villains in the yeah. second half more. Like, they're the ones having fun.
Because we talked about this, too, just the notion of, well, the escalation of the threat. You know, the first act, like we talked about, doesn't have a specific threat. We know it's coming, so there's some foreshadowing. And when Beth gets taken, it's like we see the shark, as it were, for the first time. But then we just hint at this sort of snow monster. But this is the first time we have an actual interaction with one of these creatures.
This is my favorite moment to watch with an audience, was this little bit with Howie and the gingerbread man.
Oh.
Because, you know, something's in the script.
Right.
Or then, like, you know, you're seeing it on set being shot.
Was it this moment?
It was like the whole lead up to it.
Oh, because people were squirming.
Yeah, because people were laughing. Like, everyone knows what's going to happen.
Right.
And so they started laughing, but it was just one of those things where you get so used to it, the idea of it.
Yeah.
That was my favorite moment to see with an audience and feel rewarded that there was some kind of reaction there, at least a few times we saw it with them.
Well, definitely the test audience. Cause we did a test screening, and I did a couple, actually. Mm-hmm. And yeah, the whole suspense and buildup of the gingerbread man coming to life, it was fun to listen to the audience squirm and squeal and giggle because, you know, like you said, like they knew it was coming, but they didn't know exactly what was coming.
Yeah.
And the marketing was really smart in keeping the gingerbread men out. So it was a big misdirect to show this big hook because people said they kept thinking that the hook was going to be what got them.
Right.
And then it ends up being our gingy, who was, again, a mix of practical and CG. So when he's alive and kicking and moving, clearly he's CG, but we had a few practical stand-ins involved, too. And this little moment, to me, is sort of definitely a Willy Wonka tribute. Because if anybody was Augustus Gloop, it was little Howie Jr. But I think we talked about this too, just the overall tone. Sort of being in that line between horror and fantasy, and that it was important for us that it have a dark fairy tale vibe. Are you okay? And I'm not sure, I think most people are getting it, but yeah, I think we have some people going, this fucking lame horror movie. And it's just the whole intent is that Krampus is a fairy tale character. He is. He's the witch in the woods. He's, you know, Santa Claus is a fairy tale. So yeah, what we're really trying to do is tell the story of a family that gets invaded by a fairy tale reality, but it's a very dark Brothers Grimm style dark fairy tale. And then it's all leading up to this, which is the wise old grandmother finally telling us what that fairy tale is.
Here's your moment, Todd.
Yeah.
The Campbell it up.
Yeah.
The what?
Whip out the Campbell now.
Well, then this is approaching his atonement. Where he pays a price for his actions in the first, before he crossed the threshold, you know.
Well, a fun little piece of trivia with Omi.
That guy just walked over him.
A fun little piece of trivia with Omi and her story was that initially she was going to be deaf.
Oh, yeah, I forgot.
Remember? So in the first draft, it wasn't that she spoke German, it's that she was deaf, and then Max would translate for her. But I think it was a smart change. I think her speaking German has more strength than being deaf.
For the first, like, few times I would watch any footage with her, every time she started talking, I'd be like, why is she talking? Because I had forgotten. Said we could
find joy again. But we definitely wanted to portray the Omi character as sort of the forgotten elder, which I think is sort of how we treat a lot of our senior citizens, and that they're sort of shoved into a corner and dismissed and forgotten about. And that's how we wanted to treat her for a good chunk of the movie, while obviously setting up the idea that she knows something more, which it's not like we were, that's not meant to be a surprise. You're supposed to know that from the first time you meet her in the film. But we really like the idea that it's the elderly people, it's our senior citizens who actually could be the key to our salvation, because they carry wisdom that they tend to not want to share with us because they are ignored and dismissed. And it's even worse if you have a grandmother or a grandparent who isn't as fluent in the language. Because I had so many friends and, you know, who had grandparents that could speak English but just didn't want to, because they sort of almost embrace the idea of being the outsider in the family.
Yeah, and often just being out of touch with, like, you know, let's say current technology gives the perception that an elderly person doesn't have a lot of wisdom. Like, oh, they're losing touch. They're out of it. They don't have a lot to offer. They don't understand all this stuff. But, like, truly, there's just a well of experience there.
Yeah, I just love the idea that the forgotten and dismissed character, the old person in our story, suddenly becomes the most valuable and informative because, surprise, surprise, she has experience that can help them out in the situation.
And it is kind of,
oh, wait, real quick. Sorry.
It's okay.
If you look in the background, you can see the Advent calendar.
Oh, yeah.
So the Advent calendar in the wall in the background is the same Advent calendar that Max has in his room. So we are definitely setting up the idea that the Advent calendar was an heirloom that Omi passed on to him, that one back there.
There it is.
It was actually scanned and modeled after the actual physical prop. My family into the... I'm sorry, what were you going to say?
No, it's good. That I would be next. Cannot remember. Oh, I remember. There he is. Krampus. I was just going to say that Omi and Krampus are both forgotten characters,
right,
in a way. Like, she represents, I mean, she almost has, they're almost like lost lovers to me. Like, they have, there's something romantic between them. There's like a deep connection between them.
Yeah.
And he's also a character that was popular in at least a part of the world for a long period of time, and then disappeared and was forgotten about after World War I. And, you know, started coming back. And there is a lesson there.
Yeah.
There's a really great lesson.
That this folklore matters.
Yeah.
That these legends matter. I think that's something that we all have in common, especially the Joseph Campbell fanboy over here.
Yeah.
But just that we do believe, part of the intent of the movie was to say that folklore, mythology, fairy tales, they matter even to a society that might not value them in a way that they used to. But I think part of this is about what happens when you forget folklore and mythology and fairy tales and magic, is that bad things happen. We all turn into a bunch of assholes in different ways.
That's what's neat about combining, you know, the Christmas with Krampus. I mean, I know they always go together, but is that, especially in America, Christmases, you just get rewarded
no matter what.
No matter what,
existing,
for being good.
Yeah,
like, the worst
exactly.
thing is going to happen to you is you can get some coal in your stock, and you're threatened
right.
with that, but it never... I don't know one person that's ever happened to. And
no.
then Krampus is... if it's the opposite. If you're an asshole, you're going to get... taken, whipped, beaten, and sent
yeah.
into eternal.
We need some of that
darkness.
We need some of that.
We do need a little bit of that
wrathful guy.
Yeah.
You got to keep those kids in line. Yeah, there's no more threat. But the other thing I think we've all lived through is, and God, listen, I love Disney movies. I love animated Disney movies.
Yeah.
But they took all these fairy tales and defanged them and declawed them. So they're all about happy endings
mm-hmm.
and music and little characters coming to life. But they took away the threat. They took away the morality tale
yeah.
of it, and we just wanted to tell a modern-day morality tale using the Christmas and Krampus archetypes and traditions. One thing I wanted to mention, because we did get past the animated sequence, I love the animated sequence.
Yeah.
I
oh,
love
yeah.
it. What a Digital knocked it out of the park.
Mm-hmm.
We always knew we wanted it to harken back to stop-motion animation and sort of what the old Rankin-Bass stop-motion Christmas specials looked like,
mm-hmm.
and they did it beautifully, and it's just one of my favorite parts of the film. Oh, one little funny piece of trivia that I think we should talk about.
What?
We've moved past it, but it doesn't matter. there's a shot on the iPad earlier when the kids are watching the old Christmas
oh, yes.
special. And there's an old, it looks like an old Rudolph-style stop-motion piece that was originally supposed to be the Charlie Brown Christmas special. But I think the beauty of it is that I had to hire some old friends of mine in New York from when I did animation, and they very quickly created a little stop-motion piece for the iPad. But I think that also helped set up Omi's story better, is the fact that it reminds us that stop-motion animation and Christmas kind of go hand in hand.
Hmm.
I'm not sure.
Somehow.
She says we're fucked.
Also, sorry, one more thing. Just, we keep wanting to talk about things after we've moved past them in the movie, but I really liked the scene related to what we were talking about earlier when the two girls are talking to Omi, because it's the first time anybody's actually talked to Omi besides Max.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, they haven't even addressed her at all.
Yeah, exactly. Like, she's been completely ignored until the girls realize, oh, shit, Omi actually knows what's going down here.
Mm-hmm.
And they finally pay attention to this character.
Yeah, and the kids are the ones that believe first
without
having to see anything
concrete. Well, I love the idea of Stevie and Jordan becoming believers when they were the ones who sort of instigated this whole thing by mocking MJ for his beliefs. So suddenly they're on the other side of it.
Let's get Howard and Linda. I have an idea.
There's no Campbell happening in this scene, but
for
those of you following
to.
Along, it'll come.
Yeah,
the true atonement is on the way for young Max.
I really enjoyed hearing the audience squirm and squeal in this, too, because it's such a simple, suspenseful beat without having to do much. Just the notion that the person who did wander off by themselves is going to get it.
Not being super experienced in the horror world in terms of telling stories, one thing I learned from you, Mike, a lot is like the importance of sound, and even incorporating that into the scripting process is knowing what you're hearing and feeling in the scenes.
Well, I just love good sound design, and we had an amazing sound crew.
I drive it back here, then
especially our designers and mixers, but I think sound is actually more important in a horror film than it is in a lot of other genres. You know, because romantic comedies or dramas or even dramedies, it's an element. But when you actually have to try and evoke dread and fear through sound design, that's a completely different challenge.
Yeah.
And so much of what you fear, it's what you can't see. And the best way to do that is with sound.
Yeah. In this movie especially, we wrote so much of it with sound as a presence. And so much... there's so much action that takes place off screen where the characters are listening to something or hearing something, that it was so important, and we spent a lot of time on it. I could have worked on the sound for another 2 months though if I wanted to.
And keeping the tone, keeping the comedy in that as well. You know, if you change the sound of the elves and all the creatures' voices, and they all have a sense of humor to them, the gingerbread men, if you made it scarier, it would change completely. It would lose that comedy element of it.
Mm-hmm.
They're having fun.
But the sound designers had a huge challenge because they had so many different creatures. Each creature is its own character. So, and I was really hard on them about making sure that the creatures had personality. And like you mentioned, carefully riding that line between what's scary and what's funny and cute and creepy and trying to be in that perfect sweet spot.
Yeah, we did have a lot of like conversations, like more of the intellectual snooty side of like what actually is creepy and what's scary and kind of like categorizing things. And
well, I read that the sound of a baby crying is one of the most terrifying, stress-inducing sounds possible because it's so primal and it's so ingrained in our DNA to be an alert sound.
Yeah.
You know, it's like fingernails on a chalkboard, literally to everybody, whether you have a kid or not.
And dogs barking and sirens, those are the things.
Well, it's funny because one of the notes that we did kept getting from our studio was cut back on the baby crying.
That's just
because there were definitely there were cuts where I'd let it go during the I just had the baby crying in the background for the duration of the scene. Just to see like how uncomfortable it would make people. And I think it's such a simple little thing, but it really crossed a line with a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a good example of one of those moments where it's, you know, your actors are trying to react to sounds that aren't there, but it needs to evoke dread and suspense.
Yeah, in that moment in particular, it's got to be something that stops them in their tracks.
Right.
Because if they knew what it was, they're going to head right for it.
Well, that was a huge debate in the editing room was, the noise of the parents here can't be so terrifying or jarring that they wouldn't charge right up the stairs. It had to be startling, and they had to know the girls were in danger, but there had to be additional sounds that prevented them from going upstairs.
Yeah.
That said that whatever threat is up there could be up there waiting for them. Because I wanted to make sure that we told a movie that had smart horror movie characters and not characters who were just dumbly rushing into danger left and right, but they went in armed with flashlights and guns and axes and knew that they were up against something real.
The moment that Toni Collette grabs the axe, got a lot of claps and
cheers. Oh, did it?
Cheers.
That's cool.
Because, you know, it's just...
Every audience is so different, but...
This was my favorite set.
Really?
Yeah. I just, seeing it change, you know, seeing it get covered in snow and icicles, there's something really magical about it.
I liked the set. It was just a hard set to shoot in because it was so cramped and claustrophobic.
Yes.
Because what you're not seeing in every shot are the 50 crew members hiding in the shadows or just behind the camera. And it was an attic set. I mean, we built it, but it was just as claustrophobic as a real one.
How was that?
And again, we're dealing with our digital breath, but not digital. See, I love that because it says they cannibalized one of them.
Yes.
You know? And then, like, they got so hungry that they had to eat one of their own at some point. I could do a whole spin-off movie just based off the gingerbread men.
Oh, man.
See, I love scenes like this. I love the slow buildup. I mean, it's tough because it's one of those things that in this day and age where we're dealing with people who have no attention span whatsoever, that you want them to be uncomfortable but not bored. You want them to be squirming and knowing that something is coming without drawing it out too much. But some of my favorite films, from Alien to Psycho to Halloween, they all feature these great scenes where the characters are clearly entering danger, and the threat is lurking right around the corner. But I think back then you were able to stretch it out even longer because we didn't all turn into ADD nightmares yet. which we all have collectively.
It's yes.
Oh, here comes...
comes our friend.
Our one of our favorites, the clown.
Oh, this... there is something. A little fun fact.
Everyone loves the clown for different reasons.
Yeah, I love the clown because the clown is being puppeted by... two babes.
Brett Beattie.
Well, Brett, a small man in the front. He's puppeteering the top. It's his actual arms. And then the body is two great dancers, like acrobatic puppeteer women that work at Weta.
Yeah. Great, yeah, it was my favorite was whenever the clown was being shot, all the male crew members were suddenly on set because whenever he called cut and the clown had to open up and the performers took a break, these beautiful women emerged from the tail like butterflies emerging from this caterpillar.
Yeah.
And then the head would come off and it's Brett, who's a great guy, but he's not the clown babes.
No, he's
as
not the clown
crew
babes.
Affectionately called them.
Yeah, he looked amazing, just flanked by these two beautiful women. And from the neck down, he's dressed like the clown.
But I love the clown. I loved every aspect of designing him and building him and shooting with him. If anything, I was heartbroken that we didn't get to shoot more with him.
Yeah. One fun fact about Mike is your love of creatures. I mean, that was an interesting thing because we've never, you know, we've written
creatures.
Stuff together, but we've never been through the process, and your level of involvement and enthusiasm for that, it is like seeing a kid, you know, at home with a bunch of arts and crafts get involved and being so involved in with the Weta people and them being so cool to let you get involved and to let us be a part of that process. You really get to make them into characters that you have a love for.
I just love monsters so much. I mean, to this day, my house is full of monsters hiding in corners, but this whole sequence is definitely, the attic and the whole kitchen, the intercut between the two is one of my favorites, because it's just nothing but monsters going apeshit.
Yeah.
I mean, and it's such a great combination of, we got hand puppets, full body, in-person puppets. I mean, this was one of my favorite things. I mean, I got to attack Toni Collette with a cherub licking her face, and it's like
giving her a wet willy.
Academy Award nominee Toni Collette, like, that's what I want to have, and like cursive script over the scene. But I never forget the day we had to attach the robot to Adam's back, and I was just, I think everybody was sort of like, what are we doing? Like, is this really happening?
Yeah.
And the gingerbread men, I think, were great. I mean, like, they're digital, but the marching orders to what a digital, and they really nailed it, was trying to still make them feel old school, like try to make them feel like old stop motion characters. And we considered stop motion for a minute, but it just wouldn't have had the same flexibility that the digital guys did. Oh, and the fun little piece of trivia with the gingerbread voices. So... yeah. One gingerbread man was done voiced by Seth Green. And then the second one was Justin Roiland, who is one of the co-creators of Rick and Morty, who is the voice of Rick and Morty, who Rick and Morty have a cameo in this movie that we'll get to later.
Yeah.
And then the third one was Brian Burns, who is a very close friend of mine and one of the key collaborators on Trick or Treat. So it was fun to bring, and they're all fellow animation nerds, so it was fun to sort of bring some of that sensibility. This is where I feel like we ride that fine line between slapstick.
Yeah.
Like this moment with, you know, Allison whipping off her hair and going all crazed mama bear is one of my favorite moments too, because it's such a peak for her character, who has been sort of kind of mousy up until now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she's more passive, and when she does take action, it's like one of the coolest.
Yeah.
Action scenes, saving everyone. And...
yeah. I just loved, like, Allison was down to anything.
Yeah.
Yeah, she really got into it. And the other fun thing about her is that she loves horror movies, which I think was a big reason we got her first. There's a weird aversion that a lot of people have to the genre in the industry, whether it's execs, agents, and that spreads to actors. But she is a proud horror fan. So she signed up really quickly, and she came, I mean, her recent big break, which sort of led to this role, was off the Fargo TV series, which Did you guys see it?
Oh, yeah.
It's awesome.
It's great.
Yeah, and
it's
she's just, fantastic in it. She's
amazing in it. And also, like the movie, the TV series has the same sort of dark comedy that the movie had. But it was still suspenseful when it needed to be. And I mean, that's what I really like about our whole cast is that they've all done at least one horror movie. With the exception of the kids, obviously, and Krista. But, like, all the adults, I mean, Tony's done The Sixth Sense. Koechner did Final Destination.
Wow.
Adam Scott did Piranha and Hellraiser 4 when he when he was a youngster, which is, I love Hellraiser, and
yeah.
I remember Hellraiser 4 fondly. But that they've all moved on and done such amazing different genres, that they've done drama, they've done comedy, and I think that all worked really well here.
And I think even that casting choice informed the audience, like, there are comedy people in this movie that suggest the tone.
What are
you doing? Yeah. Like, you know, people would say, like, oh, Adam Scott, like, Step Brothers, I love Adam Scott, this is going to be a funny movie.
Right, yeah.
Get him, Rosie.
So this is a piece of dark trivia.
Oh, God.
All right. I'm ready.
Do you guys,
here it comes.
Do you guys know the story?
I know the story.
Oh, I'm getting emotional thinking about it. Okay, so we just saw the family dog, Rosie, the family bulldog, get eaten and presumably die by our Jack-in-the-Box clown. So we shot this scene one morning in New Zealand and shot the family reacting to the dog's untimely demise, and we went to lunch, and we got back from lunch, and I get a phone call from Los Angeles from Ben, my assistant, who informs me that my bulldog is dying in Los Angeles.
I mean, that's a dark day.
Like, within an hour of shooting the scene of the family bulldog dying, my bulldog unfortunately passed away. So that was a dark day, and that was very weird.
That was the darkest day of shooting.
That was the darkest day, and I cried for half an hour, 45 minutes in the office, I think, and then had a shot of whiskey provided by Danny Stillman, our producer, and just kept on trucking. I did think about it for probably 2 seconds about throwing in the towel, but the show must go on.
It must go on.
Yeah, but Jabba, the bulldog, unfortunately, reached the end of his long 8 years and died along with Rosie the Bulldog in the movie. That timing's weird.
Very strange timing. I mean, he was sick for a long period beforehand,
but
I guess. But the fact that it hit the day
and
everything is unsettling.
Yeah, we had a lot of... Passings on this film, funny enough.
My own Omi, which is German for grandmother, passed right before shooting started.
Yeah. And then my final grandmother passed away on the day that we locked, when we did the color timing, I think. No, the final answer, it was the final tech check on the DCP. And we walked out and I got the phone call that my grandmother in Vietnam passed away. But throughout production and pre-production, every department had a family member pass away, and a lot of them were fathers, which was interesting. And, you know, I get it, the math, if you look at it, maybe it was mostly crew members who were in their 30s, 40s when family members start to pass away. But from craft service to stunts to the art department, everybody had somebody pass away. Which just felt odd, to the point where people actually noticed it and commented on it, that it felt strange. But thankfully, we had nobody directly involved with the film pass or even get injured. Yet. It's not too late.
Yeah, that's true.
We just, for the rest of the commentary, we just talk about death.
it's so sad.
Really, well, no, but honestly, I also bring it up because I feel like part of this movie, that's part of what the movie is about, is the specter of death and how it looms over families. And I mean, I've dealt with a lot of family members passing over the last 5-10 years, and I feel like some of those themes crept in that, you know, it's inevitable, and as you get older, you can't help but watch as aunts, uncles, cousins, and then sometimes your direct family members start to pass away, and there's nothing you can do about it.
Yeah, and it's a good reminder. It's always that thing when you say, like, how would I treat this person?
Right.
If I knew they were going to, you know, pass away tomorrow, and that is the spirit of Christmas. That's how you should approach your family members all the time. Yeah. This could be our last day together. How do you want to remember that person? How do you want to remember treating that person?
Well, you also can't help. I mean, when you reach a certain age, you can't help but realize that this might be your last Christmas with a certain family member.
Oh, yeah.
You know, especially your older ones. And then even as you get older and you're thinking about that with your own parents. And I think it's only fitting that we're now talking about this morbid subject as we're getting to Omi's moment. Well, because, I mean, like, again, you had your grandmother die during this. I had mine. And the film is even dedicated to one of my grandmothers. But this kind of a moment, I think, for Max and for Omi is such a big one because it's sort of her going back and confronting her own inevitable death. You know, that she's done her... Because the design of our Krampus even is evocative of the Grim Reaper, and that's intentional.
Yeah, his shadowed face.
Yeah.
Just like the abyss in the hood.
Yeah.
And I love that she stands fearless,
yeah.
You know, right up to him, which is so great for a character like her.
Yeah.
There's just something romantic about this scene to me.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not when
it's a reunion.
Yeah, it's not when he licks her face. That's...
No, he doesn't lick her face.
I know.
He doesn't lick it. He savors
her face and he licks the, you know, around her face.
Near, well, to me, this is one of my favorite scenes because, I mean, it's his big entrance into the film. We've only really hinted at him up until now, and it's a big character moment for her doing what she can to sort of buy time for them to get away. And, yeah, confront this death specter that she managed to escape so many years ago. And Krista said this was a scene that convinced her to take the role, which I thought was nice to hear.
One nod we should give would be to the special effects crew.
Oh, yeah.
Which was so great. I mean, running around, minimal crew, managing snow, wind.
Yeah, and just for any of the greener people listening to this film, special effects is different than visual effects. So what a digital handling visual effects, what a workshop handling creature effects and prosthetics. The special effects crew is what gives us all of our smoke and snow and
any
atmosphere.
Explosion or gunshot or usage. They're involved for all of that.
Yeah.
And a lot of the, you know, props that go along with that.
Yeah.
And they did it in an incredible job.
Well, especially when you consider all the elements they had to wrangle, especially with just little things like little puffs of smoke drifting by, all that snow drifting into the room. Mm-hmm. They worked fast and they did great. My favorite thing was learning that the same guys who rigged the explosion for the gingerbread man attack also worked on Mad Max.
Yes.
Making
giant rigs
blow up. But they were having a blast making like a little tiny gingerbread house explode. It's like, these guys are just pyromaniacs who get paid for it.
It's true. It was Sven's birthday. Yeah. It was his birthday the day we blew up the gingerbread house.
Yeah.
And he was like, can we actually blow it up? Because we had shot a plate. Remember, we had shot a plate for them to comp in later.
Yeah.
And we thought it was made out of actual gingerbread, but it was made out of wood. So there was a bunch of explosives in it, and it blew up, and the top just mildly lifted. Yeah.
Special effects and stunt guys are like the crazies, but they're the best.
Yeah.
It's just fun because they're down for anything. They're down to blow up anything or to allow them put themselves into that explosion.
Seeing that shot of Krampus in the living room reminded me that the first time Krampus was designed, Mike was doodling. We went to visit Zach working at the Hotel Roosevelt Bar.
The spare room.
The spare room.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we were sitting there talking about the story, and Mike was sketching on index cards, and that sketch evolved over time, and it, like, has pretty much stayed exactly how he is.
Yeah.
The muddy robes, the bells, the chains hanging off.
There's a wonderful book called The Art of Krampus. Did you know that, Todd?
Oh, really? Is that available?
It's available on
an online bookseller
or at Barnes & Noble, and it goes into great detail about the design and construction of all of our creatures.
Ah, I bet it has, like, amazing background paintings and concept designs.
Yeah, it's a fantastic companion piece to Krampus, The Shadow of St. Nicholas, which is a graphic novel, which is also out there somewhere. And no collection would be complete without all of the Krampus merchandise.
I mean, the ornaments, the sweaters.
Sweaters? Who's doing that? Sweaters, come on.
I'm just picturing, like, the angry nerd comment about the commentary. Like, they just started selling me shit. It just turned into an infomercial. They're selling his Krampus stuff, and of course I bought it. But they're even making the Krampus bell, like Weta Workshop's making the bell. Mm. So I love merchandise. I love ancillary stuff because I think it helps widen and deepen your story. And I mean, we were all raised on Star Wars toys, so in a lot of ways the merchandise kind of becomes part of the experience.
Mike's keeping Krampus alive even though the movie's done. He sent my niece Krampus bell.
I didn't she just had it coming.
My niece who's 5 got a Krampus bell and a letter from Krampus mysteriously from Mike.
A couple quick things about, we're not even really talking about the movie. Well, but what?
Just a side note.
What?
Once she goes away, that's his atonement with the father.
Oh my God.
Is when he's at his lowest point.
It's like I'm impressed and annoyed all at the same time.
I'm impressed.
I know, I'm impressed.
I started by wanting to pants you. Now
it's tightly structured. I'm sorry, what were you going to say before?
I don't even remember. Well, I mean, it's something that if you're actually listening to our commentary, you'll have to rewind to look for it, if you can find it. There's some subliminal imagery in the movie which nobody has picked up on yet, from what I can tell. It's here and there, and there are some loose threads to Trick or Treat that hint at it potentially taking place in the same universe. But unfortunately, some of the more direct nods to Trick or Treat ended up on the cutting room floor.
Yeah.
So maybe we'll do some side commentary on those deleted scenes later.
Oh, yeah.
I do like the idea that Krampus and Sam share a universe and get drinks to swap stories between. Like, I could see the handoff between Sam to Krampus at the end of Halloween.
Yeah, maybe we even talked about that.
Well, I actually found out, I mean, we did a bunch of research, at least I did, I don't know if you guys did.
Todd definitely did.
Just like the history of the holiday, and something that I found out that was really interesting was that in some cultures, back in the day, the Christmas season started on November 1st.
Yeah,
it was a direct line from Samhain and the end of autumn into the Christmas season. So it's actually not completely out of the norm for us to be seeing Christmas decorations in early November or even late October as we've been seeing lately.
Yeah, I went on Halloween to get some like fake blood or something from the store, and there was already Christmas stuff.
Yeah,
I was
exactly.
Like, come on. Hero's return moment here.
I don't know. I think you're off on the hero's return. No. I think you're off. I think this is the atonement, and the hero's return isn't until he wakes up.
Well, in terms of his loss, I guess it is.
I love it.
He has the conversation with him, but he's already emotionally had his loss of family. But
the hero's return is always about them having already conquered and then coming back and sharing that knowledge. Try and out Campbell me, bitch.
Well, in Star Wars, it's when he goes to Death Star. That's his return because he's mastered the Force, and his atonement is losing.
All right.
Obi-Wan, I think.
All right.
I think in a weird way, you're both wrong. For talking
probably.
<about this.
laughs> There's somebody out there looking for a way to contact me to tell me I'm an idiot.
I know, I'm just kidding.
The Joseph Campbell Foundation.
We love our Joseph Campbell, in case you guys can't tell. And if you don't know who that is, you should all Google him right now, because if it wasn't for him, we wouldn't have
a lot of movies,
especially Star Wars. Which, by the way, was fun to be in the same multiplex of Star Wars.
Yeah. It was a big moment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And like,
I mean, I felt bad for them because clearly we affected their box office.
Yeah, we really.
Results.
Yeah, I mean, they really took a big hit,
huge dent in the Star Wars box office.
But it felt like sort of a return of 80s style movies at the multiplex for the month of December 2015 because you had Star Wars dominating and ruling all, and then you had Krampus holding his own in the corner.
Yeah.
And people, you know, trickled in over time after they saw Star Wars and they were still looking for something else.
The Hellmouth forming is one of my favorites.
It's an unholy miracle. Yeah. I don't know how we did this.
Well, the guy, I can't remember his name from Weta Digital, he filmed in a sandbox.
Yeah.
He filmed some of the elements
in his
kid's sandbox.
Yeah, there was, this was another great mix of practical and digital. Because as Zach said, some shots were done using actual miniatures that were then altered in the computer later. Most of it, I mean, the formation of it after is all real set, but most of the growth stuff is digital. But these were probably some of the hardest scenes to shoot because we weren't in our usual space and there was so much digital trickery involved. But also emotionally, it's just a
stage
huge, K-stage, yeah. K-stage was a soundstage in New Zealand that they built for King Kong and was the one that we took over for all of our outdoor sets.
And this was also the last days of shooting.
Ah. Okay, so real quick. So there has been some debate online about Krampus's face.
Oh, yes.
Which I've heard. And to put any doubts to rest, yes, he is wearing a mask. In case you couldn't tell, there's a couple close-up shots of his eyes, and you can see eyes blinking behind the eye holes. But he, and in my mind, is because I could never shake the image of this sort of gaping mouth, slack-jawed creature. Because it kind of reminded me of the screen painting. But it's not that we cheaped out on his face and forgot to puppet it or didn't put CG effects over it. That's not Krampus's face.
And I think it's important that you can't read his emotion for the creepiness factor because Max really doesn't know how he's reacting to what he's trying to do.
Well,
you know, he's a hard read.
Yeah, to me, I like the idea that we never actually get to see what Krampus looks like because no one knows what Krampus looks like.
Yeah.
And that's why in the traditional Krampus celebrations, everyone's depiction of the character is different. And I think it would have been cocky of us to sort of say that our version of him is the definitive version of him.
Yeah.
Leaning on the more mysterious side felt more effective. And plus the notion that it's a skin mask.
Yeah, I always loved the idea, and we probably all have different ideas of why he does wear it, but I love the idea that he was really jealous of Santa Claus. He's like, he was popular for a while, and Santa Claus became popular, so he tried his best to look like Santa Claus.
I know.
But he's just not pulling it off.
But not that he killed Santa Claus.
No. He's trying to fit in. Like he wants everybody to like him, but he can only be Krampus.
He was the nerd
the
in high school, and Santa Claus was the popular one.
Yeah,
I'm never gonna say whose face he's wearing, but yes, he's wearing somebody else's face, and then the real Krampus face has not been revealed. But to me, it's something fun. Like Krampus is a mischief spirit, as far as I'm concerned. Like he's related to Loki. So there's something fun about him wearing this sort of Santa Claus getup to both mess with the heads of people who do see him, so that for a moment they think he is Santa Claus, versus, but also just to sort of mock the idea of Santa Claus itself.
Yeah, and because of the way that he works slowly. He doesn't just come in and grab everybody. It gives everyone time to consider what's happening.
He likes the cat and mouse of it, and he likes teaching people a lesson, as this ending might indicate.
One thing I liked about the ending, which I feel like we obviously thought about it a lot and took the time to make this point, is Max redirecting the mistakes that Omi's made.
Right.
He fixes, it's he right. he does listen to her.
Yeah.
And he learns from the past, and he does what she couldn't have done, which what she didn't do in the past, which was to offer up himself for his family, to put right. his family above himself, which is the ultimate aim of Christmas. It's right. This, that is the spirit of Christmas, but the ultimate sacrifice.
But the fun thing about the ending, and we're talking about this, and we're still in the wake of the film's release. It's still in theaters out there. And so it's kind of fun to hear about people's reactions. There's so much debate about the ending.
Oh, yeah.
And
I love it.
We have a blood oath to never
yeah.
talk about what it actually is. Because it's interesting that people's interpretations of it, there seem to be two schools of thought, which are the two that we predicted, which is, one, that the family is alive and fine, and Max gets the bell, and they're reminded that it all actually happened. Everyone seems to agree on that. That
yes.
The bell indicates that
right.
everything actually happened.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's safe for us to say, yes, that much is definite. It all happened. But the debate seems to be this next little beat about whether the family is alive and Krampus is now just keeping an eye on them in the snow globe,
mm-hmm.
or whether they are actually trapped in hell for eternity where it's Christmas every day. And I like
leaving it open.
I know.
And
yeah.
I like that people...
Because we like f***ing with people.
Yeah. And it's a good litmus test, you know, for people. It's like, where do you fall on that
exactly.
line? Like, what is your outlook on it? Is
the glass half
full or empty? It's yeah. your cynicism or optimism.
Completely.
In that moment.
Like, that's... Honestly, I feel like that's the best way to look at it. It's like, if you're a cynic and you want a dark, messed up ending...
There you go.
Where you have a... perfectly nice family, which should have earned its redemption, is now trapped in hell, then here you go. Or if you prefer the idea that the family is fine and they're just going to go about their lives with the knowledge that they are being watched and that there are darker, greater, more ancient forces keeping tabs on them, that's fine too.
And I love his workshop. It just indicates the history that he has and his legacy of all the other snow globes. And
the psycho house is right there. And if you couldn't, I think that's it. But one of the globes has the psycho house, the Bates Motel. And it has my house. My house is in there, too.
Yeah.
Oh, speaking of houses, the other bit of trivia to sneak in. Since we had to build a lot of our neighborhood digitally... There are a lot of famous 80s movie houses in some of the shots. So if you're eagle-eyed and feel like going through and hitting pause...
Then you have a lot of spare time.
Yeah. Basically, if you're a nerd... like us.
Yeah.
We say that affectionately.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
you want to scour the movie, you might see some very famous 80s movie houses. Along with some potential subliminal imagery and potentially some Easter eggs that might tie the movie to Trick or Treat.
That's me as a baby up there.
Oh, that's you.
As upper left.
That's Alex Tony Garcia in the top right. There's Zach, bottom left, and me with my family there. And we haven't aged a day. There's Adam, Tony. So basically, in case, yeah, we've got... This is our entire cast and crew, as many family photos that we could potentially sneak in.
Mm-hmm.
It just felt like the right way to end the movie.
And if you made it through our commentary this far, this is a good time to thank you for one, watching the movie and or purchasing it.
Yep.
And hopefully you enjoyed it and we had a lot of fun making it. And
hopefully you haven't lost any respect for us after having listened to it. Home video commentaries are always sort of a clumsy grade school dance.
Yeah,
in case you had any indication of what it's like to hang out with the three of us nerds sitting in a room while we talk about shit. We understand if you don't want to come over to our parties.
Yeah.
You're missing out.
Yeah.
We got monsters and puppets.
And, like, old storytelling trivia and mythology.
Yeah, Campbell. You learn something. Yeah. We should also thank Legendary.
Yes.
For all the support. They were
so awesome. Universal.
Yeah, and Universal. And, I mean, I gotta say, I guess we have some more time to kill.
Do we have to make it to the end?
Yeah, yes, we can. Yeah, well. Yeah. No, I just, this. I gotta say yeah. that especially with this being, I think, the official end of this adventure for now, it was an amazing experience. And it's, yeah. I keep saying it, but this movie is nothing but a stream of Christmas miracles, one after the other, from the genesis of it with us teaming up and writing it to convincing Legendary to make it,
yeah.
assembling the cast and crew that we did, all the way through post and marketing and distribution and release. I mean, to me, it reignited my belief in miracles. That's how I'll put it.
Yeah, and they it also was a long hard road that brought those miracles. Just yeah. like Max's own long hard road, we went through.
And if it meant sacrificing my dog and some family members along the way to please the almighty horned one, to allow him to come into our dimension, then so be it.
A lot of magic.
These ancient pagan demons, they demand sacrifice.
Yeah.
And we...
Little blood to spill.
Oh, we did forget to talk about some of our secret occult imagery in the movie.
Oh, yeah.
We'll let you guys figure it out.
Yes. Yeah. Secret
chaos magic, maybe some symbols here and there.
There's all these things that we sort of peppered throughout the film that I think are so subtle and went by so quickly that in the theatrical run that people didn't notice. But now that we have the luxury of home video and people can hit the pause
button,
screen
capping,
they might see some fun things looking back at them. Oh, and I stuck my
nephew.
Bryce? That's my nephew. I know. He worked on the movie via moral support.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was a fun little one. Oh, and our music supervisors, I have to say something about them.
Yeah.
Peter Afterman and Margaret Yen, again, worked amazing magic gathering all these songs, because Christmas music and Christmas movies go hand in hand. So they definitely pulled some favors. And then I had to dedicate it to my grandmother. It's coming. So again, thank you for listening. Hopefully this movie gives you and your family members a new tradition for years to come.
Yeah. Yeah, Merry Krampus.
Merry Krampus.
Merry Krampus. Buddy.